everyone, in this video we are going to discuss about generative adversarial networks, which are also called as GANs. If you are passionate about artificial intelligence or machine learning, you might have heard about this word GANs, generative adversarial networks. Yes, it is creating a lot of hype in the AI community because of its extended and scalable applications in almost every field such as drug discovery. And when you come into the title generative adversarial networks, these can be split into three different words: generative, adversarial and networks. So generative in the sense it generates new data from the existing data. Adversarial in the sense we have an opposition and we will compete with the opposition. This is what adversarial is. And networks in the sense neural networks. So generative adversarial networks are creating a lot of hype in the AI community from the last 10 years because it is a sensation in predictions. And when you look into deeper, you will get about what actually GANs are and why we need GANs and what are the large scale applications of GANs. Let's see one by one. See, when you go into what actually GANs are, like, these are deep neural network architectures comprised of two neural networks competing one against the other. I said the name itself, it is adversarial. So there are two different neural networks. We are comprising with two different neural networks and each competing with the other to improve their performance so that ultimately the output will be a high performance output. And it is mostly used in unsupervised machine learning problems which do not have a proper class specifier. So without a classifier, we can get into the actual output. We can get into a high performance output by using GANs because they too compete with each other. And there are two different terms in GANs. So we need to know two different terms. As we mentioned, there are two different neural networks which competes with each other. So those two we can call as generator and discriminator. So what actually these two are? A generator is used to generate real looking images and the discriminator job is to identify which one is a fake. Like when you consider an image, you have an actual image and you need to copy that image as it is like the original image. So what you need to do is you can compare with the original image, how it can run and which type of colors they use. So you actually create a portrait version of the original image and you create a fake image, right? So that version of creating a fake image is under the control of generator. So generator creates a fake image from the already existing image, or it creates a fake data from the already existing data by exactly verifying its features. And what actually discriminator does, it identify whether the generated image or generated data is real or fake. So it just identifies by investigating. And these are always in constant battle as one try to fool one another, because if they constantly try fooling one another, then they will perform in a very accurate manner, very competitive manner, so that the output will automatically it will be somewhat very excellent and high performance output. And to generate the best images, you will need a very good generator and a discriminator, because if one try to fool the other, then the other should be supposed to get fooled by the other. So it should be like an intelligent one. So both should be intelligence. If not, then there is no use of that. And when you can see the images, applications of GANs will be like, these are the images in which a real image can be converted into the fake image by using the training data. If there is an input here, which is a carbon copy or a grayscale image, and by using that, generator creates a new image. Because of that features, generator tries to portray into the form of a real image, which may be fake or real. And the job of the discriminator is to identify whether it is fake or real. In a similar fashion, when you see the examples here, this is a low quality image and the output is a high quality image. So it is a job done by the GANs. And again, these kind of images back, it is just a pencil sketch and it is converted into the color image. So these are all the varieties of applications which can be created with GANs and how actually it works. And when we create a random noise in the training set, generator creates a fake image from the originally training set. So it is a training set. Consider it as a collection of images of one particular thing, like a dog. And a generator tries to create an image using that training data set that is a fake image or it may be a real image. So the job of the discriminator is to identify whether the created image or generated image by the generator is real or fake. But when you see that, Generator always try to create a fake image because the main objective of generator is to fool discriminator. It's not to support discriminator. So that GANs will work properly. So generator always try to create a fake image and try to fool the discriminator. And discriminator is ready to mention that whether the generated image is real or fake. This is the job of discriminator as well as generator. See, let's see an example. So it is a training data set of an image of a person's face. So what generator does it by using a neural network, it create an image which is a fake image. See, these two are very different, right? So it tries to fool the discriminator, but discriminator will always investigates the output created by the generator and determines whether the output is real or fake. So ultimately discriminator generates it as a fake image. So what happens, it competes with the discriminator and discriminate tries to compete the generator, and they both try to fool one another so that they can work properly. So like we have seen most how GANs work, right? So let's see which are the areas in which GANs are working presently. This is a variety of applications created by GANs. Like if you give an input image to the model, it will create what type of haircut you want. Like it is, if it is a normal image, then a blonde hair, gender hair, aged hair, pale skin, and you can give an input. It also tell you what kind of faces will be there with respect to different emotions. Like this is a normal emotion of a person given to the model, and the model generates an angry face, happy face, as well as feared face. In the similar fashion, when you see a lot of images here, if you give an input, it tries to extract features from the original data and it creates fake images. So this can be useful in lot of movies also, right? We are going to see various characters with the same face and various hairstyles or various emotions generating. Also, we are faking your images. So these kind of things will be performed by the GAN. And also a handwritten recognition. See, this is a training data. If a person gives an input as 8, so what generator needs to pretend? It is the thing. So generator has a training set which performs how to recognize a handwritten digit. It can use MNIST dataset, which is a famous dataset for handwritten recognition. See, if the number is 8, which is written by the user, generator tries to return some other number because it tried to fool the discriminator. And discriminator is like it verifies the output generated by the generator, and it returns 0 if it is fake, and it returns 1 if it is real. So ultimately, what discriminator tries to return is a fake image because it tries to compete with the generator, and generator ultimately tries to fool the discriminator, so it generates only fake images most of the times. And this is like if you know, if you watch cartoon movies, cartoon channels, then you might know that like how the cartoon characters will be created, how exactly, like if entirely it can be created by using a manual work, it is difficult, right? So GANs will be very useful in creating cartoon characters, because if you portray pencil sketch to the GAN, it will give you a lot of images from that data, a lot of color images, lot of images with different hairstyles, with different emotions, so that the task of creating new characters is very easy. Also, it can be useful in game playing also, because in game, like nowadays games or 3D games, HD games, what the things happening is, like we need to, like suppose you to create a face emotion of the person according to the situation. We are seeing the games, right? So for that, GANs will be playing a major role. And this is what it is. Converting the images of low clarity to high clarity. Yes, this is also possible using GANs, because GANs just extract the features from the original images and try to portray another fake image. We don't know whether the fake image is real or a fake, but the generated image gives you a high clarity image because it is not just actually what the original image is. It had some new features also, and it generates based on the features of the original image. So it is easy to convert low clarity images to the high clarity images, so that we can get the images which you have taken 5 years back ago into HD now. So yes, it is possible using GANs. Yes, GANs can detect the diseases of a patient using drug candidate DNAs and molecular properties. Yes, it is also creating a lot of wonders in the healthcare. Yes, we have seen a number of applications which are positives in the GANs, There are also some disadvantages with the GANs. Like training a one neural network is a lot of heavy task, right? But training two neural networks in GAN takes a lot of time, and it is somewhat a complex task in the GANs. So we need to overcome this one to make GAN as a powerful resource in AI community. Yes, it is now itself a powerful resource and a powerful interesting topic in AI community, because it is creating a lot of wonders in almost every field. So we need to look after changes that took place in GANs and changes that took place in deep learning community. Thank you for watching.